PM, the court is going to call cause number 34925 in the interest of the Massingale Robertson children. This is an adversary hearing. The court will take notice that Mr. Robertson is appearing by telephone due to his Zoom capabilities. He's not available for a video, and he is present. And if the court can have announcements as to everyone else, please.
Marshall Rush and Heather Dugan for the department, ready.
Amy Smith, attorney ad litem for the children. They're not present. I'm ready.
Rebecca Navarro and Shani McBride, CASA.
Also present is Shelby Watkins, who is a child-facing agency representative. Ms. Rush, if you can update the court on notice to the remaining parents.
Mr. Massingale was served in Clay County on April the 10th. As of about 30 minutes ago, Ms. Smith has not been served. They both were aware, but are not here.
Thank you. You may proceed.
Department calls Charlie Parker.
Mr. Parker, if you'll raise your right hand. Sir, do you promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. You may put your hand down and you may proceed, Ms. Rush.
And Your Honor, I am sorry with all the technical difficulties. Did you take judicial notice of the contents of the file?
The court will take judicial notice of the contents of its file.
Thank you, ma'am. State your name and how you're currently employed.
I'm Charles Parker. I'm a special investigator, Department of Family Protective Services.
And I've known you for a long time. Like I said, the last time I knew you, you had hair, but I've always called you Charlie. Do you mind if I call you Charlie?
That is fine, ma'am.
I did send you an exhibit list identifying 34 possible exhibits. 28 of them are photographs, and I sent you the photographs. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Your Honor, I'd like the court to make the following findings: that pursuant to Texas Rule of Civil Procedure 21D, this court proceeding is being held electronically because good cause exists and no objection was made.
The court will make that finding.
Thank you. I'd also like the court to make a finding that I forwarded to everyone, including the court, Mr. Massingale and Ms. Smith. Obviously, I couldn't email Mr. Robertson, as well as the party, the attorneys, and CASA copies of the exhibits as required by Zoom requirements.
The court will make that finding.
Hey, Charlie, those pictures 1 through 28, did you actually take those pictures?
Yes, ma'am, I did.
And whose home was that?
That was the residence of Miss Smith, Jasmine Smith.
And at the time, was Miss Smith living there with Davian or a time Yana Max?
Yes, ma'am, that is correct.
And were you sent out to that location because of the death of Yana Massingale?
Yes, ma'am, I was.
As a special investigator, you don't have a regular rotation of investigations like Heather does. Is that correct?
No, ma'am. I go on call for a week at a time, once a month. But
and what happens? I'm sorry. Whenever. You get called out for things like conflicts, for baby deaths, that sort of thing, right?
Correct. Yes, ma'am.
And in this case, you were called out because there had been report of a death of a 7-month-old child?
That is correct.
Exhibits 1 through 28. You have reviewed each and every one of those exhibits. Is that correct?
I have.
And as far as exhibits 1 through 28, do they truly and accurately depict what they purport to depict? In other words, are they a picture of what you saw when you went out to do the investigation after the death of Yana Massingale?
Yes, ma'am, they are.
And that would have been on... Do you recall the date that you went out? Was it March 29th?
I believe it was March 29th.
And in attendance with you as well would have been Texas Ranger and an Ollie PD. Is that correct?
That is correct.
I want to talk about these pictures just in lumps for a little bit to explain why you took them. You have picture number one, which is, oh, I'm sorry, Your Honor, at this time the department moves for admission of what's been marked identification. It's petition exhibit 1 through 28.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any objection to me looking at these pictures? You're muted, sir. There you go. Thank you.
What are they pictures of?
They're pictures of the of Ms. Smith's home at the time of the removal.
Oh, no.
Thank you.
No objection.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Smith, any objection?
No, Your Honor.
Exhibits 1 through 28 will be admitted without objection.
Thank you. Do you have an unusual history with, frankly, bows and arrows that came in handy in this case?
Yes, ma'am, I do.
Okay. Just give the judge a short version of what your history is with bows and arrows.
Been shooting archery since I was a child. I used to own an archery shop here in Graham. I worked on bows. I built bows, arrows, things of that nature. Had that for about 10 years when I was working for the police department.
Would it be fair to say that you are considered an expert when it comes to archery equipment and bows and arrows?
I would consider, yes, ma'am.
Ask the court to designate Mr. Parker as an expert in archery equipment.
Any objection, Ms. Smith?
No, Your Honor.
Any objection to the naming Mr. Parker as a archery expert, Mr. Robertson?
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Mr. Parker will be designated as an expert in archery matters.
The reason I'm asking, if you look at Exhibit 1 and Exhibit 8, that's an archery target and a bow. Are you aware that Ms. Smith was supposed to be living in this home solely with the children and not with the male?
That is correct. Yes, ma'am.
And specifically not with Louis Massengill?
That is correct.
Looking at the bow that you saw and took a picture of in Exhibit 8, is that a bow that would normally be able to be used by a female archer?
Not a unexperienced archer. In my opinion, it's a long bow, probably within the 50, 55 pound draw weight range. It'd be very, very hard for anybody that's not experienced at it to draw that bow.
And you have no evidence that Ms. Smith has an expertise in archery, is that correct?
That is correct.
And looking at Exhibits 3 through 5, they're baby food cans. Why did you take pictures of empty baby food cans?
Because the cans were empty. When I go into a residence in this situation, I look for any type of formula, baby food, anything like that. I observed a Similac can lying on the table. It was empty at the time.
Okay, why did you take pictures of Similac cans? Was there a specific reason you took those pictures based upon what Ms. Smith told you?
At that time, just because it was the baby food, the baby formula. Later, I found out that she was feeding the child Similac until she got on WIC and then went to Infamil.
Did you see any Infamil cans?
Yes, ma'am. There's one on the photograph.
Okay, well, we'll move on then. Regarding the pictures 20 through 24 that the exhibit list shows us kids' sleeping arrangements, and the actual photos say kids' bedrooms. Could you tell the court what those sleeping arrangements were for the three living children?
Looking at the photographs, when you first enter the room, directly in front of you is, it's supposed to be like a bunk bed. It runs, the top bunk is rather high, runs east to west along the northern wall. And then to your left, it curves around and runs along the north and south wall. Below that is on the west wall is another bunk bed. And as you're looking at photograph 21, it shows the top bunk along the northern wall. Underneath that is the bassinet. From what we were told, Diane slept on that top bunk area, and Yana was sleeping in the bassinet underneath that bed.
You're calling them bunk. Are they actually bunk beds, or are they actually just shelves that run along the wall?
To me, it looks like shelves because there's no type of support railing to keep the children from falling off of those bunks.
And does the railing, does the shelf run the length, not just the length of 6 feet, which would be the size of a bunk bed?
Correct.
So these really aren't even bunk beds. They're simply shelves that she had the children sleeping on.
Correct. Yes, ma'am.
And there were no mattresses. They were just pillows, correct?
That is correct.
And regarding, I believe it was picture 21, which petitioner's exhibit 21, which shows the bassinet. That picture was actually taken after the ranger removed the pillow and moved the bassinet. Is that correct?
That is correct. Yes, ma'am.
However, is that the bassinet that Ms. Smith said Yana was sleeping in?
It is. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Was there a pillow that the ranger removed and took into evidence?
Yes, ma'am, there was.
Okay. Was it like a little kid pillow that a child would sleep on, or was it an adult pillow that was being used as a mattress?
No, ma'am. It appeared to be a full-length pillow that an adult would sleep on.
The counters, cabinets, the food. Did Ms. Smith say that the food was in Exhibit 16 was what they'd had the night before to eat?
Yes, ma'am, it is.
Okay. Were you able to ascertain if it was just one day old food or older than that?
I was not able to tell. Okay. It appeared old when I looked at it.
And then you showed cigarettes in both the bathroom and on a table as well as outside, correct?
That is correct.
And finally, Exhibit 12 is the couch. Who was sleeping on the couch the night Yana died?
We were advised that Kinsley had been sleeping on the couch. She fell asleep that night, and Ms. Smith just allowed her to sleep on the couch.
And it looked the way it looks in Exhibit 12 when you came in?
That is correct.
Pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson? Sir, yes. do you have any questions for Mr. Parker?
I do not.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
No, Your Honor, no questions.
Mr. Parker, can you verify Ms. Smith's legal name?
Jasmine Smith.
Thank you. Your Honor,
if I may redirect a couple more questions on Mr. Parker.
Certainly.
Mr. Parker, were you able to talk to the park manager where Ms. Smith was living?
Yes, ma'am, I was.
And did she inform you that the RV park has security cameras?
Yes, ma'am.
And did she at some point tell you that one of the cameras happened to be pointed at Jasmine's trailer?
That is correct.
And that she had video of Mr. Massengale coming into and out of the trailer multiple times, but there was no video for the date of Yana's death. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Did you talk to Ms. Smith about the death?
Yes, ma'am.
Was the rangers present when you spoke to her?
No, ma'am.
And to your knowledge, did the rangers also speak to her?
Yes, ma'am, he did.
I did not ask the court for entry of the exhibits showing the outside of the trailer. But could you tell the court what the outside of Ms. Smith's trailer looks like?
The outside of the trailer was really nice. The trailer appeared to be fairly new. Of course, it had the pullouts. It appeared to be a rather expensive trailer.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Now I pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, have you had a chance to come up with any questions for Mr. Parker?
So you are not for sure if Louis Massengale was present the night this happened?
Mr. Parker, please answer that question.
I'm sorry.
He asked if you were unsure if Louis Massengale was present the night of the death.
I am unsure. Ms. Smith denied that he was there. The cameras were inoperable for that evening, so I have no proof that he was actually there or not.
Okay. Thank you. That's it.
Ms. Smith?
No questions, Your Honor.
Any other questions of Mr. Parker, Ms. Rush?
Yes, ma'am. Mr. Parker, Mr. Massengale hasn't spoken to you, has he?
No, ma'am.
Pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, any questions? Every time an attorney gets to ask a question, I have to go through each one of you. Any questions, Mr. Robertson?
I have no questions. Thank you.
Ms. Smith?
No questions.
You may call your next witness.
Department calls Garrett Robertson.
You may proceed, Ms. Rush.
Mr. Robertson, I know you can't see me, but I am Versal Rush, and I am the attorney for CPS, okay?
Yes.
So I'm going to ask you some general questions right now. Do you spell your name? Did you say yes?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. You're currently in the Daniel unit in TDCJ?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you the legal father of Davian?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Were you married to Ms. Smith when Davian was born?
No, ma'am.
At some point, were you made legally the father by an attorney general order or an AOP? What happened?
No. I mean, I signed the birth certificate. And, I mean, I guess that was as far as it went.
Okay, that's well. Did you sign it at the hospital?
Yes.
Okay. It's probably an acknowledgement of paternity. Have you ever been in any sort of lawsuit, whether it's the attorney general or CPS or a custody suit with Davian?
I mean, I was put on child support.
That's what I mean. So what county did they put you on child support?
I think it was Wichita Falls. I'm not sure.
Or, if it wasn't Wichita, do you think it was one of the counties around here?
It might have been Graham or Mineral Wells. I'm not sure.
Wherever, it's Texas. Is that fair?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we will find it. Did I ask you, is Davian born 13? August
20? Yes, he is.
Okay. And you said you've never been married to Jasmine Smith. Is that correct?
I have not.
Okay, so I'm going to double check. If you don't know, that's okay. But does she spell her name about right, Jay?
Yes.
Okay. And let me just remind everybody we're on YouTube, so we'll leave off the full birth date.
Oh, I apologize, Your Honor.
No, that's fine.
Mr. Robertson, are you or any member of your family a registered member of any Indian tribe?
No, ma'am.
So do you know if Jasmine Smith is a registered member or her family of any Indian tribe?
Not that I know of.
And you've never seen a card that says she's a member or seen anything that Davian is a member. Is that fair?
No.
Okay. You are currently incarcerated out of Jack County. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
You had a deferred adjudication for aggravated assault, family violence with a weapon. Is that fair?
Yes.
You were denied parole May 9th, 2022, and your next review date is May 2024.
Yes.
And you were denied parole because of your criminal history, the nature of the offense, drug or alcohol involvement, and your adjustment period. Does that sound about right?
Yes.
You received on May 3rd, 2019, a sentence of 8 years. Does that also sound right?
Yes, ma'am.
Department moves to admission of what's been marked for identification. It's Petitioner's Exhibit 29, which is the certified copies of cause number Robertson that match the testimony he's just given regarding his conviction, his deferred adjudication, and his charge.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any objection to me looking at the paperwork that confirms your testimony?
No.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
No objection.
Thank you. Petitioners 29 will be admitted without objection.
Mr. Robertson, I know you've been served with the petition. Have you gotten any paperwork to fill out for child placement suggestions?
Yes, I have, and I filled it out, and I put it in the mail today.
Okay. I'm not going to go into details on that because we'll get it in the next couple of days. Are there people you ask in Texas?
Yes.
And to your knowledge, do the people on the form have any CPS history or any criminal history?
No.
Okay. You know if they do, that's not going to work out.
I understand that.
Okay. Do you agree with me that your daughter should not live with Jasmine?
I definitely agree.
Have you had any contact with Jasmine in the last month?
No.
Okay. When was the last time you saw your daughter?
When she was 4 years old.
And she's over 9 now. Is that fair?
Yes.
Have you been contacted by Stephanie Pickerel?
Not name does not sound familiar. No.
Okay. I'm going to tell you, you're going to be contacted by Ms. Pickerel. She will be the caseworker if the court continues us as temporary managing conservator, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
She will send you paperwork and she will send you envelopes to return paperwork in. Do you understand that?
Yes, ma'am.
And do you understand any questions you may have, you go to Stephanie Pickerel for answers. Does that make sense?
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
I will also tell you, because obviously, unless things have changed, you don't have email access. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
You'll be getting stuff from the legal department like orders and documents that are filed. You don't need to return those. Those are for your own records. Do you understand that?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you understand as of 2:55 on April the 12th, 2023, the department is not placing Davian with you in prison?
Yes.
Okay. And do you agree with the department not sending Davian to prison with you?
I definitely agree.
Okay. And you understand that we'll look at your child placement form. That's what Stephanie's going to do. And we'll see about finding someone who might be able to take care of her for you. Does that make sense?
Yes, please.
I'm getting ready to pass you, but I'm going to ask you, is there anything you think any of the people who are here, that includes your child's attorney, your child's guardian ad litem, that's the non-attorneys who look out for her, and the caseworker, as well as the judge, while we're sitting here, is there anything we need to know about Davian or about Jasmine or about you before I pass you?
No.
Okay. Pass the witness.
Thank you. Mr. Robertson, I'm Amy Smith. I am the attorney for your child and her siblings, and just have a few questions for you. Can you tell me when the last time you did have contact with Jasmine was?
Dude, it's been a long time. The last time I seen Davian was the last time I guess I talked to her.
Okay. You pretty much answer my next question, but I'm going to ask you anyway. Have you been in touch through letters or any other type of communication regarding Davian and how she's been doing since she was four?
No, none.
Okay. Do you have any way of knowing, or did you have any way of knowing where Jasmine was during this last few years? When you contact?
My grandmother has some friends or something that kind of knew kind of what she had going on, and I kind of got a little updates about what she had going, and because I'd be asking and trying to get information about my daughter, and they would let me know.
Okay.
How she was.
Okay. So, to your knowledge, does Davian have a relationship with your mother or your grandmother? I think you said. I'm sorry.
Does she have what?
Sorry. Does she have an actual relationship with her?
My grandmother said that she spoke to her a few times. One time not too long ago, probably about a month ago or so, she said she ran into her at the store or something and talked to her.
Okay. Anyone else in your family that you're aware of that has an ongoing relationship with her?
Not an ongoing relationship, no.
Okay. And then just quickly, do you know if you are going to be where you're at for the time being for a long time or until your next parole hearing, I guess?
I'll be under review in December. And, I mean, I should come home. I mean, that's almost 6 years on an eight. I mean, should give me parole.
Okay. And then Ms. Pickrell, that Ms. Rush was just talking about, who is your caseworker, do you understand that you have to actually let her know if you are moved or if anything changes about your incarceration, like your parole is granted, things like that?
Yes, I will. I'm definitely going to keep the update on that.
Okay. I will also send you my information via mail so that you have that. And I'll pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, why have you not been keeping in contact with your daughter for the last 5 years?
I mean, I've wanted to, but they were, Jasmine was supposed to set up like a PO box or something where I could get a hold of her, but nobody's let me know where she's at, and she keeps moving around and being placed in different homes, and so I haven't been able to know directly where she was at.
And I'm not going to ask, but the names you put that might be a placement for your daughter, can you just tell me what the relationship is? It a mother, sister, brother, uncle?
It's a cousin.
And where are they located?
They're in Jacksboro.
Okay. And do you know if Jasmine has any family members that you would think would be appropriate for placement?
No, I don't think so.
No, that's fair enough. This case involves all three children, so I appreciate you helping me with that. Is there anything, sir, you would like me to know regarding your current situation, your daughter, or this case that's not been discussed?
No.
Do you know if you have, if your daughter has any medical or health issues?
I mean, I'm not up to date on that because it's been so long since I've seen her.
No, I was just making sure you didn't know if she had anything like diabetes or something that was a long-term issue.
Yeah, no, not that I know of.
Yeah, great, thank you. Thank you. Ms. Fresh, you may call your next witness.
Department call Stephanie Pickerel. State your name and how you're employed.
Stephanie Pickerel, Permanency Case Manager with 2Engage.
As such, have you been in contact with Jasmine Smith?
Yes.
And have you been in contact at different times with Lewis Massengill?
Yes.
Texting. I don't mean you've seen him, but texting or whatever, right?
Correct. He has not. He's only responded to me one time.
Okay. So you know that Mr. Massengill has been served?
Yes.
And you know that Ms. Smith has not, but she was aware of the Zoom and got the link, correct?
Correct.
So about 1:30 or sometimes between 1:30 and 2, did you get a text from Ms. Smith?
I did.
And that was today?
Yes.
And what did the text say?
She stated that she knew that Lewis's phone was out of minutes and that her high-speed data wasn't working, and she didn't think she was going to be on because she was having issues with her phone.
Did you suggest they either go to a CPS office, go to a library, or try to hook up the phone through the Wi-Fi, like when you can make calls on Wi-Fi when you're out of minutes?
I did.
And you did that through text?
Yes.
Did anybody respond to you?
No, she did not.
Pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any questions for Ms. Pickerel?
For who?
For the caseworker.
Ms. Pickerel. There isn't any... Like, I'm not losing my rights to my daughter, am I?
No, sir. This hearing is simply to determine whether or not the children remain in foster care at this time.
Okay. No, I don't have no questions.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
Thank you. Stephanie, where are the kids placed right now?
They are currently placed in a foster home.
All together? Is that correct?
Yeah. They are all together.
Okay. And when did they get placed there?
Saturday, the 8th. April 8th.
As far as you know, so far, so good with this placement?
Yes.
Okay. You were made aware by me that Davy and my client had a desire to possibly be placed with a previous foster parent. And since we're on YouTube, I'm not going to get into specifics, but do you recall discussing that with me over email?
I believe so. I would have to look at the name again to know for sure.
Okay. There were reasons that that wasn't an option at this time. Is that correct? Do you at least recall that part?
Yes. And now I remember the name.
Okay. Okay. So were there potential safety concerns regarding this previous placement?
Yes.
Was it decided at that time it would not be in the children's best interest to pursue that option?
Yes.
Do any of the kids have any behavioral issues that have already been identified?
They have not fully been identified, but they are presenting themselves. We did get the cans back, but unfortunately, I have not had a chance to review them fully.
Okay. Have you had a chance to visit with them on more than one occasion?
I have visited with each child at least twice.
Okay. Just from those couple of interactions, was it clear to you that there are some behavior issues that need to be addressed?
Yes.
Okay. Briefly describe who and what kind of issues.
Kinsley has been, her negative behaviors have been physically aggressive towards adults, her siblings. Jaden responds in kind when her sister attacks her. Davian, I believe a lot of what she doesn't physically, isn't physically aggressive as far as I've seen so far. But she's very careful with how she talks, and she will correct herself if she thinks she's, if I ask further questions on something. She's very cautious with how she speaks with me.
Okay. And you, or to engage in general, has already started these girls in therapy, correct?
Correct.
And is the plan for them to continue in therapy at least once a week?
Yes.
And Miss Dooley, who's the current placement, she's been a foster, or this has been a foster home for quite some time, correct?
Yes.
You have a lot of experience and it's a great home. Would you agree with me?
It's a fantastic home.
Okay. So do you believe that they'll be able to meet the needs of these three girls at this time and going forward?
Yes.
Did Jasmine, or the one time you spoke with Lewis, did they identify any special needs of the girls?
No.
Have you been able to get any of the belongings for any of the girls?
No.
Have they asked for any that you're aware of?
Let me correct that, please. At the first parent visit with Jasmine, she did bring the girls a favorite toys and two of the girls' iPads.
Okay. Thank you. I'll pass the witness.
Ms. Pickrell, has what parent visitations have occurred?
We have had two 1-hour visits with Jasmine and the girls. I observed the first visit. The second visit took place last night at Charlotte Marsh. I haven't received the observation form on that yet.
Mr. Massengale hasn't had any contact with the children?
He has not.
Do you know if he is adjudicated or legally established as the father of Jaden and Kinsley?
I do not know.
Thank you. Ms. Rush?
Stephanie, Davian requested the ability to go to Yana's funeral. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
The other two children, did they voice the same desire?
Not at that time, no.
Okay. Was any of the children allowed to attend the funeral?
Yes.
Which ones?
Davian.
Are you aware Davian specifically told the CPS when the children were picked up that she knew Yana was dead?
Yes.
Okay. And she is the oldest of the three children. Is that fair?
Yes.
Did she see the mother at the funeral?
She did.
Was there any problems?
There were no problems.
Okay. Were there plenty of people from two engaged CASA CPS to make sure there would be no problems?
Myself and Rebecca Navarro escorted Davian.
And Ms. Smith had been told what the rules would be?
Yes.
Okay. Have you had any bad reaction from Davian from having attended the funeral?
No.
And did that decision, was that made with the assistance and input of both the attorney ad litem and the guardian ad litem?
Yes.
And because of Davian's age, do you believe it presented some closure and some catharsis for her to say goodbye to her sister?
Yes.
Pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any questions for Ms. Pickrell, the caseworker?
As far as permanency, does my cousin have it, like, will my cousin be able to have her over this other placement that y'all have?
Typically, we usually look into kinship placement over foster care.
Okay, that's what I was wanting to know. I know y'all are trying to keep them together, but at this point, I'd rather hurt for my family.
Any other questions, sir?
No.
Ms. Smith?
Nothing else, Your Honor.
You may call your next witness.
Department calls Heather Nugent. State your name and how you're employed.
I'm Heather Nugent. I'm an investigator with Child Protective Services.
And at least at some point, I will call and pronounce your name correctly. Is that right?
Nugent, yes.
Were you the investigator who was assigned?
Yes, ma'am.
And did this assignment occur after the department learned of the death of Yana Massengill?
Yes, ma'am.
At that time, did the department believe that jurisdiction was in Jack County?
Yes, ma'am.
Was that based upon advice given to you by a different attorney?
Yes, ma'am.
And was that based upon the fact that removal had been accomplished in Jack County that had been dismissed and a temporary, I'm sorry, court-ordered services case had been filed in
Congress? Yes, ma'am.
And based upon the fact that you had been told that jurisdiction was in Jack County, did you staff and discuss this case with a separate attorney?
Yes, ma'am.
And at that time, was it after 4 o'clock and were you informed you, I'm going to back up, okay? Were you informed to hold off until interviews were completed at the CAC and with the law enforcement?
Yes.
By the time that occurred, was it after 4 p.m. and too late to get a court order?
Yes.
Are you asking this court to find that there were exigent circumstances, specifically that a child had died under suspicious circumstances, the mother was being investigated, and there were some other issues regarding violation of court orders that required you to have an exigent removal to maintain the safety and security of these children?
Yes.
Okay. Department moves for admission of what's been marked for identification as Petitioner Exhibit 32, which is a certified copy of petitioners for temporary order, as well as 33, which is the court order in that case from February 16th, 2023, and Exhibit 34, which is a certified copy of the March 2nd, 2023 court order in cause 2302019.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any objection to the court looking at the previous CPS case orders?
No.
Thank you. Smith?
No objection.
Petitioners 32, 33, and 34 will be admitted without objection.
Are you aware that the previous case, before it became court ordered, was brought by the department because of allegations of physical abuse in the home by Mr. Massengale and Ms. Smith?
Yes.
And domestic violence, is that fair?
Yes.
And that the court ordered services indicates that Mr. Massengale is the legal father of the children. Is that correct?
Yes.
And though the removal was later dismissed, is it your understanding that in the removal he was found to be the legal father of all three Massengale children?
Yes.
The petitioner's exhibit 32 indicates a birth date of Mr. Massengale as one as Ms. Smith. Do you have any reason to believe that is not the correct birth dates?
No.
They also have the birth dates of all three of the time Massengale children, Kinsley, Jaden, and Yana. Do you have any reason to dispute those birth dates?
No.
So let's talk very quickly about the March 2nd, 2023 order. It was filed on March 6th and is Exhibit 34. You got a copy of that when I sent you the exhibits, correct?
Yes.
And is it your understanding that specifically under just number three orders on page two, all visits between Mr. Massengale and the three children, which would include Yana, were to occur for 2 hours weekly under supervision of the department?
Yes.
There would be no overnight visits until he did BIP. Is that correct?
Correct.
And there was to be no less restrictive visitation unless everybody agreed, correct?
Correct.
In your investigations, did you discover that Ms. Smith and Mr. Massengale were violating those terms of that order?
Yes, they were violating them.
In fact, did Ms. Smith admit to you that she was letting Mr. Massengale come?
Yes, she did.
And when you look at the exhibits, if you look at exhibit number 17, there's a photo of affirming Texas family's card for victim classes. Is that correct?
Yes.
And that was identified by Mr. Parker as something he took a picture of at the home.
Yes.
Have you ever spoken to Mr. Massengale?
I'm sorry. I couldn't hear you.
Have you ever spoken to Mr. Massengale?
Briefly.
And what did you tell Mr. Massengale when you spoke to him? Was it to set up an appointment?
Yes.
And did he say he'd come by?
Yes, he was supposed to meet me at the sheriff's office.
Did he?
No.
Has he talked to you at all about anything in this case?
No, he has not.
Department moves for admission of what's been marked for identification as Petitioner's Exhibit 30, which is the conviction certified paperwork in cause 4461 for Mr. Massengale for the felony offense of burglary of a building.
No objection.
I'm so sorry.
Robertson, do you have any objection to me looking at Mr. Massengale's criminal conviction?
No, I do not.
Petitioner's 31 will be admitted without objection.
Oh, that was, I thought 30. If I said 31,
I'm sorry, 30 will be admitted without objection. Thank you.
And department's moving for admission of what's been marked as 31, which is cause 4462, certified records of a conviction for a prohibited substance in a correctional facility for Mr. Massengale.
Any other exhibits that you're going to admit? Robertson, do you have any objection to me looking at the second conviction for Mr. Massengale?
I do not.
Ms. Smith?
No objection.
Petitioner's 31 this time will be admitted without objection.
Ms. Nugent, as is required and as is your habit, did you run criminal histories on Mr. Massengale? Mr. Massengale? Yes. Did his criminal history include a referral for a juvenile aggravated charge, as well as multiple adult charges in Jack County?
Yes.
Including as recently as August 2022, possession of marijuana?
Yes.
Your run for Ms. Smith showed no charges as of that date. Is that correct?
Correct.
Is it your understanding that at this time, the Texas Rangers are still investigating Ms. Smith to see if she has any culpability in the death of Yana?
Yes.
Once again, Mr. Massengale has not spoken to you, so you don't know if he was there that night or not. Is that correct?
Correct.
Have you looked at the photographs 1 through 28 that have been entered into evidence today?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. You did not go into the home. Is that correct?
Correct.
Did you go to the Virginia's house for the interview of the children?
I did.
But looking at photographs 1 through 28, do you believe that the home conditions shown in that photograph constitute endangering surroundings for children the age of these children?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe returning these children to Ms. Smith and that location would constitute a continuing danger?
I do.
To your knowledge, is Texas Rangers also investigating whether Mr. Massengale may or may not have been present?
Yes, they are.
Do you believe, let's back up. Is it your understanding that Mr. Massengale did not complete his services under the Jack County court-ordered services?
Correct.
And I'm so sorry, I should have asked you, were these children removed from Young County, Texas?
In this removal, or yes, this removal, yes. This one.
And in fact, were they living in Alney, which is a town in Young County, Texas?
Yes.
Based upon Mr. Massengale's total lack of cooperation with the investigation, his not seeing his children while they've been in care since this removal, his being investigated, his criminal history, and the fact that there have been previous allegations of domestic violence for which he did not follow court orders in Jack County, do you believe returning his children to him would constitute a continuing danger?
Absolutely.
I believe the children's drug testing came back negative on all children. Is that correct?
I have not seen the results. I'm sorry.
Okay, that's okay. However, Ms. Smith came back positive for marijuana. Is that correct?
Yes.
Based upon what may be the reason
the Texas Rangers are investigating, does it concern you that she had small children in her home while under the influence of marijuana and one of those children died?
Yes.
Do you agree with Mr. Robertson that his daughter cannot be placed with him?
Yes.
Do you believe it would be a continuing danger to place Davian in prison with her father?
Yes.
Are you asking the court to name the department temporary managing conservator?
Yes, please.
Are you asking this court to name Mr. Massengill, excuse me, temporary possessory conservator of his two children, and Mr. Robertson, temporary possessory conservator of his one child?
Yes.
And are you asking the court to defer any finding as to Jasmine Smith until she can be served?
Yes.
Do you agree with me today that Mr. Massengill has not appeared at all?
Right.
That as of today, these children do not meet the requirements of ICWA to be considered Indian children.
Correct.
And is it your understanding that Mr. Massengill has passed CPS history and in none of those cases was his children ever determined to be Indian children?
Correct.
Are you asking this court to prohibit any visits between Mr. Massengill until he takes a UA hair drug test and makes contact with Ms. Pickerel?
Yes.
And no contact means none. No letters, no phone calls, nothing, correct?
Correct.
Because Mr. Robertson is in prison, are you asking this court to allow him to have contact by mail through to engage Ms. Pickerel by sending letters and receiving letters that are appropriate?
Yes.
Are you asking this court to order both Mr. Robertson and Mr. Massengill to comply with further orders of the court and any family service plan that they may have?
Yes.
Once again, are you asking the court to defer anything as to Jasmine Smith since she has not been served?
No.
I mean, we can't put her under orders, right?
Yeah, right.
Are you asking the court to find that there were good grounds for the exigent circumstances?
Yes.
Are you also asking this court to specifically order Lewis Massengill to notify the department of his email address, to keep the department updated if it changes, and to open all of his e-files?
Yes.
Is it your understanding as of right now, we don't actually have an email address for him?
That's my understanding, yes.
Obviously, are you also asking the court to order Mr. Robertson to notify Ms. Pickerel and to engage if he is paroled or if he is moved?
Yes.
Are all of these in the best interest of these children?
I believe they are. Okay.
You're asking this court set a status hearing for May 25th at 9:30, permanency hearing for August 24th at 9:30, and another permanency for December 14th at 9:30.
Yes, please.
I want to ask you real quick, did you see the children's behavior before the CAC interview?
Yes.
You heard Ms. Pickerel say that they're having some negative behavior. Did you see that?
I actually was kind of a victim of Kinsley. Yeah, she bruised up my arm pretty good.
Did you see Kinsley and Jaden basically beating up? And I don't mean adult beating up, but hitting on, bothering, doing more than just sibling playing with Davian?
Yeah, I would actually call it adult beating up. They were ripping out her hair, punching, kicking her in the head.
And did you, is that how you got hurt when you intervened?
Yes.
How did Davian respond?
She was very sweet and actually very patient. She took up for them. She was saying that it was okay and that she wasn't hurt. And
does it concern you
that
these children may have been doing this behavior for a while against Davian?
Absolutely, yes.
Did you watch the interviews at Virginia's house?
I did.
Were you present when, are you the one who literally picked up the children?
Yes.
Okay. And were you present when Davian, as I say, sua sponte, just said, I know Yana's dead and nobody, it's not like anybody really killed her.
Right, yes.
That surprised you?
Yes.
Which is kind of a shocking thing. I'm sorry.
Yes, it was kind of a shocking thing to hear.
When you watched the interview, did Davian do anything unusual?
She kept looking at the camera. She's been interviewed several times. And she also asked if her mom was going to see the interview.
When you watched, have you watched interviews before, either CAC or just interviews with kids?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you get the idea Davian may have been coached?
Yes.
Would you agree with me? There's no way in the world that Mr. Robertson was the one who coached her.
Yes, agree. Yes.
Pass the witness.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any questions for Ms. Nugent?
I do not.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
Thank you. From your observations of the children, did it appear that Davian had taken on a parental role with the other children?
Very much so.
This family has an extensive CPS history, to say the least. Would you agree with that?
Yes, 100%.
And so Ms. Rush did already talked about the allegations of physical abuse, which led to the Jack County case in question. But in that same case, weren't there also allegations made by Kinsley regarding sexual abuse by Lewis?
I know that at some point there were, and I can't remember which case that was, so I don't want to lie. I'm sorry.
So fair to say that there has been an outcry by Kinsley, sexual abuse by Lewis. You're just not sure of the exact timing.
Yes.
And Mr. Lewis, as we've already found out, has a history that includes aggravated sex assault when he was a juvenile, correct?
Yes.
And he also has a reason to believe for sexual abuse with CPS. Is that correct?
Yes.
I'll pass the witness.
Nugent, when you removed the children initially, what type of placement were they in?
They were put in a shelter in Wichita Falls.
And are any of the three children, to your knowledge, on any type of medication?
No, not to my knowledge.
Thank you. Ms. Rush?
No questions.
Mr. Robertson, any questions?
No.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
No, Your Honor.
Thank you. Any other witnesses, Ms. Rush?
Department arrests. I believe all of my exhibits have been admitted. Is that correct, Your Honor?
That's what my records are documenting.
Department arrests.
Mr. Robertson, do you have any witnesses you'd like me to consider?
No, I'm not sure who she's been around and who's all been a witness to this. So.
Thank you. Is there anything else you'd like to tell me that you haven't already told me or already been asked?
No.
Thank you. Ms. Smith, any witnesses?
No, Your Honor.
Thank you. Do you have a recommendation?
Yes, my recommendation is that the department maintain TMC. The children's current placement, I believe, is in their best interest and is least restrictive. I have had a chance to visit with the kids, and they've been through a lot, and I think that Ms. Dooley will do a great job with them. And I've been happy to see that To Engage has got them in therapy so quickly and is trying to help these girls.
Thank you. Ms. Navarro, do you have a recommendation at this time?
Just that I agree with the attorney ad litem and the department.
Thank you. Mr. Robertson, you're currently in prison, as you know, but you have the right to request a court-appointed attorney. However, it's a two-step process. One, you have to be opposed to what the department is doing. And at this time, your testimony has been that you agree that your daughter can't come to live with you, and you agree to provide a placement, if possible, for your child. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
You also have the second part of that is that you have to meet the financial requirements, and I honestly don't know anything about your finances. Ms. Pickrell will send you an indigency affidavit that you will need to fill out. And if your position with the department changes, then we can readdress that request for a court-appointed attorney in the future. You also have the right to hire your own attorney if you want to do that at any given time. And you also have the right to participate and represent yourself like you've done today. Do you understand that, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
And I'm sorry, will you just give me the first name of your cousin in Jacksboro that you have put on your child placement form?
Her name is Onita.
Onita, thank you. Have you spoken to Miss Onita about being a
My grandmother? My grandmother's been in contact with her. They've been talking about this whole situation, and that's why I have her as a placement.
Okay, great. Thank you. At this time, then, the court is going to make the following finding. The court is going to find that there was sufficient evidence to satisfy a person of ordinary prudence and caution, that there was a danger to the physical health or safety of the children, which was caused by an act or failure to act of the people entitled to possession. The court further finds that it is contrary to the welfare of the children to remain in the home of a parent, and the urgent need for protection required the immediate removal of the children and reasonable efforts consistent with the circumstances and for providing for the safety of the children were made to eliminate or prevent the removal of the children, and those reasonable efforts have been made to enable the children to return home to a parent, but there is still a substantial risk of continuing danger if the children are returned home to a parent. The court does find that the information for an exigent were surpassed and does approve the exigent removal on March the 29th of 2023. The court is going to name the Department of Family and Protective Services as the temporary managing conservator of the child, Jaden McKinsley and Devion. The court is going to name Mr. Massengill as a possessory conservator of the Massengill children and Mr. Robertson, a possessory conservator of the Robertson child. The court is going to find to name, the court is not going to name Jasmine Smith any type of possessory since she has not been in front of the court. The court is going to order each of the parents to undergo parenting counseling that can be both individual and family, to attend and appear for a substance abuse assessment and follow all recommendations, to participate in random drug and alcohol screens. That random and drug and alcohol screen must include an expanded opiate panel, as well as testing for fentanyl. The court is going to order each of the parents to undergo a psychological evaluation and comply with all of the recommendations, obtain and maintain employment, obtain and maintain housing, help develop and comply with their family service plan, keep all parties updated with their contact information, email, relationship, and job status, allow announced and unannounced home visits, and to provide in-kind support, attend case meetings and court hearings, sign medical, mental health, and drug releases, and to provide an email or mailing address. Mr. Robertson is to provide a mailing address. Mr. Massengill is court ordered to provide an email address to be added to e-file, and he is court ordered to open the email within 3 days of receipt. The court does find that the reasons these children were removed is not based under any of the 262.116 factors. This removal is not based on the fact that children may have been homeschooled, that came from an economically disadvantaged background, the parent received a nonviolent misdemeanor charge, the children received medical marijuana or were behind on immunizations or engaged in independent activities, nor that a parent sought out a second medical opinion, or that the parent and children tested positive for marijuana in a way that endangered the physical or emotional well-being of the child alone. The court is going to order specifically for Mr. Robertson. He is to notify the department of any change in his facility within 10 days of the move. He is also to provide to Ms. Pickrell in writing all of the services that are available to him in his current facility and whether or not he is eligible for that. In addition, he is to specifically fill out a medical history report as to his family and to cooperate with the department. In addition, regarding, he also will have the standard visitation order. He may have contact or access to his child through cards, letters, and gifts. Those will need to go through Ms. Pickrell and through the child's therapist to make sure that those are appropriate and that the child is in a place to receive that information. In addition, any family members that specifically Miss Onita and his grandmother may also send correspondence to the child through that same process. In regards to Mr. Massingale, the court is, in regard to Mr. Robertson, any child support or medical support obligation that is currently ongoing will cease as of the date of the removal of his child, which is March the 29th of 2023. If any payments are received after that date, they will go towards the arrearage only. In regards to Mr. Robertson, Mr. Massingale, there'll be no contact or access between the children and Mr. Massingale until he completes a hair follicle, a urine sample, and alcohol testing if requested, and he must meet with Ms. Pickrell. In addition, he will have supervised visitation alone. He is not to have any cards, letters, access, telephone, email, FaceTime, any type of electronic access until those things are completed. And there is a recommendation from the children's therapist that that contact is appropriate and under what terms and conditions that contact would be appropriate. The court is going to order Ms. Pickrell that in regards to Mr. Robertson, the department to engage has 5 days to run a criminal background check, CPS check on Ms. Onita. And if those come back clean, then the court is going to order an expedited home study, order be completed and prepared, and a home study to be completed in 10 days. The court is going to find, as of on the behalf of Mr. Robertson, there is no Indian heritage. The court is going to set this for a status hearing on May the 25th of 2023 at 9:30. A permanency hearing is set for August the 24th of 2023 at 9:30. The second permanency hearing is set for December the 14th of 2023 at 9:30. There shall be no visitation between Ms. Smith and the children until she has been served. She must undergo a hair follicle and a UA with all of with the opiate and the fentanyl and alcohol if requested before there's any access to the children and the mother in any shape, form, or fashion. Ms. Pickrell, if you will please go over the visitation requirements. There's not to be any cell phone use. There is not to be any discussion of what happened with Yana, the condition of how Mr. Massingale is doing, the what could happen in the pending investigation, or anything to do with any discussion on the outcome of the child protection case. If that happens, that visitation is to stop immediately, as well as the normal terms and conditions. Mr. Robertson, I need to let you know, and this is not a threat in any way, I'm required by law to let you know that if you're unable to provide your child with a safe and stable home environment, your parental rights to her could be restricted or terminated. Sir, do you have any questions for me?
Do not.
Thank you, and thank you for attending. We will, my court coordinator will certainly set up for your appearance at the next hearing. I urge you to keep in close contact with Ms. Pickrell. She's a very good caseworker, and to keep in contact with Ms. Smith She's very experienced in these matters, and your daughter is in good hands with both the caseworker and Ms. Smith as her attorney. Best of luck to you, sir. Ms. Rush, is there anything additional that I need to address that has not, that I have failed to mention at this time?
Are you deferring an Indian child finding on the other, on the Massengill children?
I am at this time. I have no idea of Ms. Smith, and so.
Oh, I just needed to put it in the order, Your Honor. That's all.
Anything else, Ms. Smith, that I have failed to mention or I needed to clarify?
No, Your Honor, thank you.
I am going to, before we leave, I am going to ask the department to look into the grief counseling at Children's Grief Counseling Camp that is offered through Hospice of Wichita Falls. I know they have a summer camp that, and see whether or not that would be appropriate for the children to attend or not. Anything else?
No, ma'am.
Then we will go off the record, and thank you for everyone for your hard work on this. I know this was a tough case for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.